We will have Mike Barry and Brian Karge. They're both currently working on master's degrees in computer science at WPI, and their MBTA data visualization project was expanded from a graduate course assignment on data visualization at WPI.
All right, good morning. Thanks for coming out. And thanks to Tom and Kate for inviting us. Really excited to be here today. I'm Brian Card. This is Mike Barry. And we're going to be talking today about how to build a large-scale data visualization. It's a really great time to be interested in data visualization. There's a lot of energy right now. There's all sorts of data available, which I think is fueling it. There's public data from governments. You have private data from your internal organizations. And then we're starting to see personal data from wearables. And so there's all this information you can collect. And combined with these open source tools, some of which we're going to be showing you today, it's made it easier than ever to go out and create visualizations and gather insights. Mike and I, as part of a course project at WPI, we created this project, which is on the same size and scale as some of the visualizations being put up by major news publishers and other organizations. And we're going to talk to you today about how we did that and then also how you can do it too. So real quick, project history in brief. Like you said, we're both software engineers. This is a course project. We started this in the spring. Here's just a brief timeline. We started collecting the data for it actually in February, and then it took several months to build. We published it in June, and then now we're here. I'm going to walk through the visualization really quickly for those who haven't seen it, just so we have an idea of what's going on. This first diagram shows you all the train positions over the course of a day. Time is going down, and you can hover over this diagram, and you can see the trains update on the map. And we provide these annotations on the side to try to explain what's happening to here. So for instance, interesting things like here's a disabled train and the effect that it has on the rest of the system. A little bit of a funny story, this actually happened to me this morning. I think it's the T getting back at me for picking on it. So karma, that's how it works. This next one shows how many people are entering and exiting the stations. You can see here where the popular stations are on the map. They're all sort of in the middle, which makes sense. This last one shows you how long it takes to get from one stop to another based on the time of day. The blue line at the top here is the amount of time you're actually on the train, and then the orange line is how long you're waiting for the train. And so the combined of those two is your transit time. So it's actually the space between those two black lines is the average time. Okay. This is some of the press we've gotten. This is from local and sort of international data visualization experts. We've also gotten some press from news publications. We won a best interactive data visualization on Reddit. We made it to several best visualizations of the year lists. It's been a really humbling experience. And we did it without spending any money. And this is a whole bunch of stuff. This is the project management tools, the data for the actual visualizations, the visualization tools themselves, website publishing, all the bandwidth, the code hosting, sharing our project resources, and even the tools to create this presentation. Right. So if you have a computer and an internet connection, you can create the exact same thing. Right. So how did we do it? The first thing we started off with was research. Right, and all the librarians are excited, right? So this was the foundation of our project. And we looked at a couple things. First was what we were going to do, then what else was out there and through the visualization literature, and then finally trying to brainstorm and collect ideas. So we'll start with the first thing. We really wanted to have a goal going in, you know, and this was part of a course project, so we were required to have a goal. And we started off with something like this. And it turns out that that doesn't make for a good project. And so we started to think about what types of things would be interesting to other people. You know, one of the parts of this data set that was really appealing to us is the broad applicability. A lot of people ride the train. So we thought if we could find things that were interesting to ourselves and also interesting for other people, then we could make a good project. The other thing here is that it was really important that we did this ahead of time. So when you start working with a data set, you tend to think in terms of what's easy to do with that data instead of what's actually important to people. And so by having really clear goals of what we wanted to show, we were able to focus, you know, sort of when we got into crunch time, to make sure that we were picking up on those things that we thought were we really wanted to show. And these are the things we focused on. Where's the congestion and delay in the system? How do special events like snowstorms and basketball games affect the system? And then as a commuter, can I look at this and take something back to my own commute to make it better? And we had a lot of ideas. So I showed you three, we probably had two or three dozen different things that we were thinking about. And most of them didn't make the cutting board, but that's sort of part of our process, was just to try to come up with as much as we could. And you know, it's also helpful working with two people, right? Because you come up with things and it makes someone else think of something else. And this brings us to sort of our first set of tools that we use, which were collaboration tools. And these might be actually the most important ones that we use in the whole project. So we put everything through Gmail and Google Docs. Gmail is great for just emailing people, but eventually it gets a little bit complicated. I mean, we started off tracking things in notebooks and emails and eventually moved them online to Google Docs. If you've never used Google Docs for collaboration, it's a really great tool. You know, we essentially had just documents and you can go in and comment on them. And then the comments send emails out and you can reply back and forth in emails, and it saves the comment history in the doc. And so it's one of the best tools out there for doing that type of work, getting feedback. We also started to use Trello later on. Trello is like a task management tool. It's essentially used to make lists. And you can make lists and columns, and you can move tasks between lists. We actually start off with a couple different ways of sort of managing what needed to be done, and this is the tool that we ended up using much later on before we actually had several failed tools. But if you haven't used Trello, I recommend taking a look. It's really great for sort of tracking what you're doing. Afterwards, we looked at the existing literature and tried to figure out what else was out there. This included, you know, train visualizations and reading and things like that. We're actually not going to talk about this. Lynn's going to do a much better job than we would covering this stuff. But just to mention that we spent quite a bit of time on this and it was really important. And then finally, once we had a good idea about what we wanted to do, we started to brainstorm. And this is actually a really simple process. We just drew things on pen and paper, took pictures with cell phones, and uploaded them to Google Docs, and then using that comment system like I described, that's how we got feedback. So here's one of our mock-ups, right? Nothing fancy happening here. Mike drew this one, and he actually told me as we were dry running that he made this mock-up while waiting for his car to get inspected, right? So, you know, just notebook, scribble down whatever it is, and I mean, there's a whole bunch of different ideas. We had probably five or six different pages, just every single way we could think of looking at the data and different designs and things like that. And the thing that's nice about having really messy mock-ups, not to pick on this one, but if they are messy, then you're a little bit freer to give feedback, right? If someone sits down and spends 3 hours drawing this beautiful mock-up and you don't like it, then it's harder to give that feedback. So just having lots of messy mock-ups is great. So after we had a good idea about what we wanted to show, we had a whole bunch of ideas. This is when we started actually getting the data and then starting to work with it. And so this is sort of the real meat of the project. The data is available online. So we started with the train positions, right? And the way this works is that you can go online and you can look at the MBTA's API, and it will tell you the current position of all the trains at that moment. And we wanted to look at it over the course of a whole month, and there's no way to go back in time. So what we did is we periodically reached out, and then we grabbed the information on there, and we saved it to a file. And we had two systems doing this. So Mike had a system, I had a system, and essentially every 60 seconds it would go out, it would grab a file, and save it down to disk. It was really important that we had two, because every once in a while something would happen and one of the files wouldn't be saved. And this was pretty common. But most of the time, the other one was working, and so we could have two copies of data. So when we had all of it, we then took both data sets and we merged them down into one good data set. And that's what we used. We had all this data, and we had a bunch of ideas, and we needed to somehow get from the data to the ideas. And you might be in a similar spot. You know, maybe you have access to data. Hopefully it's not as hard to get your data as it was for us. And so I'm just going to walk you through sort of the process that we use to fill in one part of one visualization. So if we take this one, for example, that's the original idea. This is the finished product. It's not quite a one-slide transition to get there, but what we're going to do is look at seeing how we can figure out the colors for this. Right? So we want to show the delay in the system. We want to show how much slower or faster a train is than normal. And we can do that if we can figure out the speed of the trains or how long it takes them to get between stops. The API gives us JSON documents. JSON stands for JavaScript Object Notation. Looks like this. It's very popular these days for representing data. So you see it a lot on the web. JavaScript is the programming language used in web browsers. And so it just makes natural sense for things hosted on the web to be in this notation, which is really easy to do it. A lot of data visualizations are using web-based tools now, so you encounter a lot of this data format. And it contains a whole bunch of different details about what the different trains are and where they are. Something interesting here that we focused on were the train predictions. So you can see it gives you information about the stop and how long it thinks it's going to take to get to that stop. And this is what we use to figure out how fast the trains were moving. So giving an example in a slightly confusing diagram here. We had timestamps for all our files. This is, you can imagine, every 60 seconds we're getting a new file here. And these predictions are going to start counting down. So maybe it'll start with 210 seconds, and it'll eventually count down, and it'll get to 0 seconds here. And by the time it reaches 0 seconds, we knew that the train had arrived at the station. And so then we could take the difference to say, all right, when did this countdown start? When did it reach zero? And that is how long it took to get through one segment of the train system. And you'll notice here the time is 240, and the starting prediction time is 210. So we didn't actually use these predicted times. We want the real times. We don't want the predicted times. We want to know actually how long it took to get from one end to the other. So here it's 240 seconds. The next thing that's interesting is if we look at the top part of this file is the trip ID. So a trip in this system is a train moving from one end of the line to the other end of the line. That's one trip. And then it gets back and it turns around and then that's another trip. So each of these entries have a trip ID in it. And what we can do is we can essentially just keep track of trip IDs and how long it took to get through one segment. So here's our 240 that we just derived, and we can do this a couple more times. Maybe the next time it takes 220, it's a little bit faster. The next time is 300, it's a little bit slower. And here they're all sort of sorted by using these trip IDs. So now we have a whole bunch of data, and also we have times here, which is not in this table, but you know, we have the time that it took for that trip. So now we can say, all right, at 9 a.m. it took 240 seconds, at 9:05 it took 220. At 9:15, it took 2:30, and we can build that list of all the times and how long it took, which is kind of what we want. All right. So again, we want to fill in this, and we figured out all the different times of the day, and we just went through the process of deriving the data for this much. Yeah. So don't do this by hand. You know, and we didn't. We used a computer. We used a whole bunch of other tools too. Node.js. This is a. So we're talking about JavaScript before. It's the language of web browsers. Node.js is for server side, so with outside of a web browser. This is what we use for all of our data processing. It's a whole bunch of different libraries. This is not really typical to do everything using this framework. I feel like it's a little bit more adopted, but people usually, when they're doing this type of data analysis, use Python or R, or there's a whole bunch of statistical tools that are custom fit for it. We actually chose this because then we just had to work in one language. All the data visualizations are built up in the browser, so we kept everything consistent. We only needed to learn one thing, which was great. D3, that's the actual framework that's used to create the data visualizations. All the colors and lines and sort of linking everything together. That's what this framework does. And then we used Bitbucket. So Bitbucket is a code repository. It allows you to go in, you can create an account, and then you can push up code and share it with other people. There's also GitHub, is maybe a little bit more well known, but the thing about GitHub is when you post code, it's public to everyone. And we wanted to actually keep things private so that we could work on it, and that was one of our choices. So we used Bitbucket for this. Iterate. So here's the scary thing, is that not all of the ideas that look good on paper look good with real data. And we also had this problem with the JSON documents. If you look at them, we had 6,000 of those files. We had essentially no idea what our data set looked like. The only way that we could look at it was by building visualizations. And then we would build one, and we would look at it and say, well, is this showing what we wanted it to show? Maybe we're trying to show that the trains were really delayed, and we would build one and it wouldn't show that at all. So we would have to go back and say, well, what's interesting here, and can we build another prototype to highlight it? These are all sorts of visualizations that didn't make the cut or changed drastically, you know. But this process really allowed us to refine our ideas and come up with a set that worked really well. And it was also part of the structure of the course that allowed us to create so many, because there was deadlines, and so we had kind of a big gap before when we had to stop working on prototypes and start working on the data visualization.
Okay, so once we had an idea of what our data was starting to look like, and we were starting to see which of our mock-ups translated best into prototypes, looking good, like Brian said, with real data, we started to think about how we were going to put all of these ideas together into the final presentation. So one thing we learned going through the prototypes is that each of the different views of the data answered a different question better than other views of the data did. So we knew that we would have several different visualizations embedded in the final project. We weren't going to have a single Uber view that answered all the questions. So when thinking about how to organize this, we could have had a slideshow or implemented, say, custom navigation between each of the visualizations. But one thing we kind of noticed looking through some of our favorite visualizations from the past couple of years was that they all seem to be tall web pages and just use scrolling to navigate between the different sections. This is really simple. It's really elegant. People instantly understand it, and it takes no effort to implement. So we kind of decided that we're just going to have a single tall web page and have all the sections embedded within it. So, of course, we started out with Google Docs, you know, lather, rinse, repeat. So we had filled in an outline of our visualization here. So we had each of the sections. We had all of the content that we wanted to say based on some of the insights we had learned from doing prototypes with the data, commented back and forth on things, and just put in placeholders for each of the visualizations, saying, I'm going to put an awesome visualization here that's going to answer this question. And once we were good on that, Google Docs is really great for going back and forth on the content. Once it gets into code, it's hard to kind of iterate on that and go back and forth and make comments. So once we're happy with this, we put it into this template over here, and that was the start of our visualization. So we just had all the text, and in the code, they're hidden here, but we just had a placeholder put awesome visualization here. Around this time, we started to realize that we only had 10 days until our project was due. So we started to pick up the pace a little bit. We did a little bit to make some reusable libraries and things that would help us making the final project. But really, we kind of just started banging out visualizations as fast as we could. So this was the first Git commit of the final project, just a couple of files, and April 18th, which is 11 days before it was due. And then we started coding frantically. We made a bunch of decisions, had a lot of conversations back and forth. Even more things started fleshing themselves out, or started, even more of our questions started getting answered when we got deeper into building the actual final project. So for example, we decided to adopt the MBTA's Helvetica font that they use on all of their signs for our headers and try to make our headers look like MBTA signs. We eventually changed that, but it seemed to be good at the time. Also, about 9 days into this, and we're also working full time, so all this work was happening in the morning, after work, and then on the weekends. So we started getting a little weary and making some math mistakes. And also, one thing we did, which I don't recommend, is we pulled code directly from our prototypes into the final project. It's always better to start from a clean slate and fix the mistakes you made the first time around. But this helped us get a lot of stuff done in a really short amount of time. So finally, on the 29th, we turned in the project. It had grown from this to these files. But we felt like we managed to keep it under control because we incrementally added just one piece at a time when it made sense. We didn't just go and pull everything over in one fell swoop. And this is what our final project looked like, a little bit different than what we showed you at the beginning. We'll talk about that in a minute. So one thing we learned when we were going through and pulling all of this together into the final project is, like Brian said, some visualizations look good on paper, but then when you put actual data into them, they don't work quite as well as you thought they would. But then also, some things that you try, some little things that you try that you hadn't planned on doing, just a random idea that comes up, ends up looking really good. So the general rule of thumb that we followed is that if you find one of those things, go and use it everywhere, repeat it all over your visualization. So for example, we were only going to put this map here alongside the Mary diagram. But that ended up being such an effective way to tie the data back to something that was relatable to people that we ended up using it everywhere in the header, next to this one, and next to this one. So that was really effective. Another thing is we knew going into this that we wanted to use a lot of words. We wanted to liberally annotate all of our visualizations. We wanted to have paragraphs describing some of the insights you should be learning from them. And one thing we tried in one place was hovering over some of the words describing a visualization to actually changing and highlighting things in the visualization itself. And that worked so well, and we liked how that felt when you used it, that we ended up using that all over the project. So those are just two examples, but that happened a bunch of times. So the deeper you get into a project like this, the more you lose sight of the big picture as you're working on all the little details, trying to flesh them out. So it's really valuable to get feedback. So for example, we got feedback from a lot of significant others, coworkers, people who rode the train, and ways that they use your visualization incorrectly actually give you really, really useful feedback, because what the trick is that they're actually correct and your visualization is wrong. So that gives really, really useful feedback. Also, things that they don't understand and questions that they still have after they do understand what you're trying to present. So we kind of gathered that and had a lot of really useful feedback that drove the final design. Also, if you're able to get a hold of anyone with professional data visualization experience, one of their feedback can be really useful. So we are connected with a local data visualization professional, Bill Shander of Beehive Media, and we, as part of our final paper we had to turn in for this project, we sent our project to him, and he looked through it and gave us some feedback and gave us some really useful insights into things he might have done differently, things that he felt like he wanted more of. kind of their experience in the field can give you a lot more than someone who's just coming at it from a consumption experience. And of course, our professor also gave us some very, very good feedback, critical feedback after we turned in the project. So we were done. Well, not quite. So we had this project. We wanted to show it to people. We still had all these loose ends that we wanted to tie up. And we had all this great feedback that we didn't have time to act on because we pretty much got it the week before it was due and we're still trying to finish it. So we decided to turn it into a side project and take care of a couple of last minute things before we went and showed it to people that we knew or tried to publish it. So the final project came together in about 10 days, but then it took us another month of tweaking on it in our spare time at a much, many fewer hours per week than we did for the final project to get it to where we wanted it to be. So these are a couple of the things we'll do. I'll step through each of them in a little more detail. So this was our professor for the class. His main feedback was use chart keys, because we just showed each of our visualizations with data encoded different ways and didn't explain. Well, we explained with words what our encodings meant, but we didn't explain with pictures that looked like the visualizations. So we added chart keys to all of our charts, and each of these little things takes about as long to make as the chart that it represents. So, and about as much code too. So it took a long time to make them, but they really ended up making it self-explanatory for people who came in from random angles. So they added a lot to the final product. This is Bill Shander. Some of the advice that he gave was for specific visualizations like this one. He said at first we had details for each row below the table, which didn't really make sense to him. He kind of made the comment that we should pull it up and try to show that in the table itself. So the final project, we did just that. As Brian showed, you can click on a row and it expands out and you can see the details below it, help tie it together more. He also said something didn't quite work with him for the Mary diagram. Like, he wanted to see more details about each of the lines. So we made it so that when you click on this version here where we line up the start times of each of the lines in the Mary diagram, when you click on one of those, it expands out, grays out all the other ones, and shows you the details, all the stops and the time along the way. So those were two really good pieces of advice. So another thing is that Brian and I developed on MacBooks. So everything looked great on a MacBook. Everything worked just right. Bill was using a high-resolution monitor, and he made the comment that we should use more of the available screen real estate. And my dad looked at it on an iPad and said it didn't work quite right. It was a little bit too wide, so you ended up getting some scrolling from side to side issues. And I had another friend who said if he can't look at it on his iPhone, he's not going to look at it at all. So we knew we had to do something to adapt all these devices. So we pulled in Bootstrap, which we talk about. We have a handout with some of the frameworks that we use, and it's also posted online. We can show you afterwards. So Twitter Bootstrap Library helps you do just this. It helps you adapt down to smaller screens and then fill up bigger screens and explicitly control how that resizing behaves. And also we made sure to test this on all the major browsers. We developed on Chrome, but then we knew people coming to it would be using all sorts of different browsers. So we tested those on Mac and on Windows. For Internet Explorer, some people are still using versions that are 10 years old. So at some point, you just have to kind of give up. So for people using Internet Explorer, I think less than 9, we just rendered a tall screenshot of our visualization that we generated from one of the real browsers. And also gave them a link to where they can download one of the real browsers. One final thing bugged us about our report. We gave a lot of high-level information and showed a lot of trends between different parts of how, how the people affect the trains and how the trains affect the people. But we didn't tie it back to numbers that actually meant something to people. So we decided to add one more visualization, this one, which Brian showed at the beginning, which lets you select two stops and drag between them and then shows you the detailed breakdown of the delay in transit time between those stations. So this implements what's called the martini glass pattern. So the martini glass pattern, you start with a overarching view of your data, hopefully attention grabbing to kind of draw people in. And then as you work your way up the stem, you dive down into more focused visualizations of different aspects of your data with very constrained points of interaction to bring them along and tell your story. And then at the very end, you open it up to exploration, to the fun part. So for people who took the time to make it all the way through the visualization, this last part at the end gave them something to explore, something to dig deeper on, and hopefully get some kind of actionable information out of. So then we had to decide exactly where we were going to host our visualization. There are a lot of web hosting platforms out there, but one kind of stood out to us as being really simple to use, and that's GitHub Pages. So if you push a website with static files to GitHub Pages under a certain branch to GitHub, then they'll host it for you. So they hosted it for us at mbtaviz.github.io. And this is drop-dead simple to use. It's free, it's unlimited, and we knew we could get any amount of traffic, although we didn't really expect to get that much. And they would handle it just fine. So then we had to do a bunch of just last minute things that have nothing at all to do with data visualization, but just had to do with getting the project ready to be published. So we put a date in the header of the date we were planning on launching, so that when people came across the page, they would know that it was fresh. We use a free service called Add This to just generate all these buttons for social sharing programmatically. That was partially to encourage people to share it with other people, but also to give it some amount of credibility when people came to the site. We use Google Analytics, which is a super creepy service provided by Google that lets you see how many people visit your site and the number of unique users and how long they've been there. But it's pretty much common practice to use it all over the web now. So we wanted to see how many people actually stumbled across our visualization. Then we added a couple of tags to our main site that tell Facebook and Twitter and a couple of other social sites how to render an image, description, and title for your page when someone shares the link. So we wanted to, it's nice to kind of control that, because then your branding flows whenever people share the link. So finally, the date that we had put in our header that we're planning on launching came around. So we don't really know anything about marketing. All that we do is occasionally consume content on the internet. So what we decided to do was post our visualization to the places where we discover content, which are Reddit, Twitter, and Hacker News. They seem to be the simplest ones to actually post something to. So Reddit there's a Data's Beautiful subreddit that people post a lot of visualizations like this to, and we knew that if you made it to the front page of Reddit, you'd get a lot of traffic, although we really didn't expect to make it there. So that was a good bet. Hacker News is a site that engineers, software engineers a lot go to share links to different things and comment on them. Visualizations that do well there are typically pretty highbrow, pretty sophisticated, so we thought that was more of a long shot, but we decided to try it anyway. And Twitter, I only had 100 followers at the time, even though I worked there. So that could be kind of hit or miss, so we decided to tweet it at a couple of influential people in the data visualization community with the hopes that they would retweet it to their tens of thousands of followers. So, launch day. We made all those posts around 9 a.m. I think it was a Tuesday. And almost instantly, it was amazing, almost instantly, within a couple of seconds, my mom replied and told me. She was really proud and happy to see what I had been working on all spring. But then sure enough, as the day went on, we made our way up Hacker News to the top of there for like 5 minutes. We made our way onto the main Reddit page, so we got a lot of people visiting from there. And then a lot of people, this is the inventor of D3, and this is the guy who you should read all of his books, Edward Tufte. We linked to, described those in our handout a little bit more. So they tweeted about it, which was awesome. They each have a lot of followers. It's just really awesome to get recognized by these people that we look up to so much. And this shows the Google Analytics referrals. So of the people who came to our site, where Google Analytics thinks that they came from. So Hacker News doesn't show up as any referral, so that's most of this other category, along with some of the other ones that don't get tracked as well. But you can kind of see it made its way and disseminated throughout there. And overall, on the first day, we had about 100,000 people view it. And then since then, about another 100,000, so a pretty quick trail off. Now, I thought my mom's tweet was going to be it, so that was pretty awesome. We really weren't expecting any kind of reaction like that. We were pretty blown away by it. And you know, since then, in the months since then, it's given us a really great excuse to get more involved in the local data visualization community, to meet some people like Lynn, who's talking next, meet some of you today. It's just been a really, really awesome kind of stepping stone for those things. So wrapping up, in the grand scheme of things, trains are actually pretty boring. There's lots of other interesting data sets out there, and there's tons of free and open source tools available for you guys to use to visualize them. We use a particular set of tools, and we describe them more in our handout if you want to learn more. So yeah, always focus on answering questions. We always came back to, in our visualizations, does this visualization answer the question that we're trying to answer? And usually the answer was no, so we scrapped it. Follow the best, so watch the New York Times, some of the visualizations coming out from them, Flowing Data, they post a lot of the best visualizations that are showing up now, some of the people that we talked about here. And also, even though we plug a particular set of tools that work for us, the most important thing is that you find a set of tools that works for you and you get really good with them. So for example, if you get pretty good with three or four different sets of tools, you're not going to be as well off as if you get really good with one set of tools. I see people constantly struggling just to decide which set of tools to use, and if you can use that effort to visualize data and get better with one particular tool set, then you'll be much better off. Yeah, so the question was about the MBTA API. The data, they basically just have a URL that you hit, and you download the data from that URL, and it's different every minute that you check it.
And is that stored on the GitHub hosting site, or is it on the browser?
So you can go and grab it in a browser, and it'll just look like one of those JSON documents that Brian showed. But what we did was we wrote some program running on old laptops and set them up in each of our houses, so that a program would go and download the data from that URL to disk. So we ended up with all these thousands of files on disk, and then we wrote some scripts that would loop through all of those files and then batch them up into the clean and merge data set. Does that answer your question? All right, so the question was about a real-time version of this. And no, not yet. There are a lot of good apps out there that you can play with that hit the same API and do that. But if there was one solution that worked really well, then Brian would have been on time today.
Sure. So the question is, how repurposable is it? You can actually go to our GitHub repo, and we have a little bit of documentation about feeding in information into our visualizations. They're not really that malleable. So you could, for instance, take the same data for another month and process it and look into it. If you wanted to change it to a different subway system, for instance, it's a lot of work in there to redo it, particularly in the like the map graphics and things like that. That would have to all be changed. It can be repurposed, but it's a little bit difficult. So I'll go first. I got an A. I don't. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Just making sure. Just making sure. So my work didn't know about it, and as it was going on, right? I mean, this was a course project. It turned out a lot better than we expected it to. So there was no reason to really try to talk it up. Afterwards, there actually hasn't been any change in my day-to-day job. So for better or for worse, you know. And I'm also, I mean, the company I work for is, we do a lot of telecommunications and things like that. So there certainly is a growing interest in data visualization, but it hasn't affected me that much.
And I also got an A in class. And nothing like that. This is very, it's pretty separate from, it's completely separate from our jobs. But I think I've noticed afterwards, like Twitter has groups that do data visualization. So I've talked to them a little bit, just on random things. But it really hasn't changed what I do day to day. There are a couple of different projects coming up that I may end up helping with or giving some input into that are doing some pretty data visualization heavy stuff. But overall, day to day, not really too much change.
So the question was, we're working with collaborative tools. There are any tips and tricks, things that worked really well, things that didn't work so well?
So I guess to-do list was probably one of the things that we struggled with the most. Like Brian said, we went back and forth on emails, and then eventually we put stuff in Google Docs, and we're just deleting stuff when we were done with it. And then we had files in our code called to-do.txt, and we would put stuff in there and delete it along with the check, the git commit that that implemented that feature. We also use Bitbucket issue tracking a little bit, which is not really that great. I don't recommend trying it. But Trello really kind of emerged as the best way to take care of that. Any other aspects of it?
Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing was just keep track of what's left to do and who's working on what, and then also having a shared vision, right? So at some point you have, you know, you're both working separately, but you have to be on the same page about what you're trying to do. And that's really where that shared vision part, that's what Google Docs help with a lot, you know, because our general process with this was to maybe be a couple emails back and forth to say, hey, I'm thinking about doing this. And then we would just go right there, create a document, and just write a paragraph, two paragraphs about what, you know, an idea. And then that would go out to the other person, and they would go in and comment on it and think about it. Then we would just expand that from there. And then if it, you know, if we were both sort of on the same page, that would be a cool thing to do, then start going in with mock-ups or something else. Yeah, I mean, really the combination of Google Docs with Trello with email, that really solved a lot of our problems trying to track things. And then we also did, not sure how much we did code reviews.
We didn't have time.
I'm trying to think. Yeah, so if you're working with in any sort of code base with more than one person, it's a good idea to do code reviews.
Bitbucket actually does handle that pretty well. If you have pushed your changes in a specific branch to Bitbucket, then you can open up what they call a pull request, which basically shows the changes that you're proposing that you make, and then other people in the project can go and make comments on it. You can go and change it. And then when the person reviewing it says it's ready to go, you click a button and say, okay, I'm good with this. And then just from the web UI, you can merge that right in. So that actually is pretty nice. We didn't use it that much on this project, but recommend checking that out if you have enough time to be able to do that.
So the question is, MBT's API was in JSON. We use Node.js, and essentially were there limitations to JavaScript? If we had more time, would we have done something different? I think it turned out pretty well. I mean, the big advantage is that, you know, the JSON documents, working with that data construct is pretty much native in JavaScript. So it's really easy to just sort of go drill in and get the information you want. We use a lot of open source libraries for data processing, which we didn't mention, that made it easier, you know, to sort of work with the data and put it together. I think we originally tried to use Python. I know Mike looked into it originally.
Yeah, I think we're really bad with, or at least I'm really bad with Python. So the equivalent task in a Python script ended up taking 5 times longer than the Node.js one. So we decided not to do that. Lynn, I'm sure, could tell you ways where you could have done it way faster in Python. I don't think I would have used any other language to do it in. One of the nice things about this particular set of tools we used is that people don't use this for data processing a lot. And one of the traps you can get kind of sucked into is trying to use a very high-level framework that takes a long time to learn and wants you to do things their way. Whereas this one, we just kind of read in files. We did exactly what we knew we wanted to do to them and then wrote them back out. So we kind of cut through a lot of the layers of things we would have had to learn and potentially might not have solved our problems.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Instead of all of these bright colors, bees see different colors. They see some things that we don't see, and we see things that they don't see. The world to humans is very hot, so we see reds. Bees do not see reds. We can see more yellow and orange and hot colors, and bees are more cool in what they see.